just when you thought it was safe, it is absolutely, positively not. And good Thursday evening to you. How the hell are you on this beautiful day? This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I think that we're going to have a very controversial yet informative show on this evening. I really think we are. This evening I'm going to be speaking on corruption in the church of God in Christ. Now, some of you saints will be offended. I don't give a damn. Some of you are not going to want to hear some of the things that's going to be shared on the program tonight. My guest in a few minutes will be the one and only Stella Award winner, Moses Tyson. Moses has been on this journey that he's on, I know, at least 8, 9, 10 years. I went through all the receipts, mostly all the receipts, I couldn't go through all of them, that Moses has sent me over the years, copies of lawsuits and copies of information, copies of fraud, copies of bishops involved in sexual offenses, copies of information where the average Church of God in Christ member would not know, of the information they would not know. And when I got to about 600 emails that I have from Moses Tyson, hell, I just stopped. I was going to copy it. Too much paper. So I'm going to have the emails brought up here on the site on tonight. I've talked to Moses at least 3 times today. He's been receiving calls from other Darius. Don't ask me no question. I'm doing this is a talk show. If you have any questions, you'll be able to call, but don't start asking me no fucking questions. I got too many emails, so I'll be bringing it up here on the screen in a matter of a few minutes. I told Moses to call me about 7:15. Oh, also want to remind Tina Blunt, Tip Taylor, James Thomas, Darren Tenort, Latrina Marie, Isis Jones, Monica Jackson, Selena Archie, Andrea Britt, Felicia Teller, Deja Savard, Lachey Gates, Janice Devo's, and Linda Steele, your packages are in the mail. Why do you go live and then don't want questions? Man, you and your mammy can kiss my motherfucking ass, Daniel Randles. This is my motherfucking show. Ain't nobody's rules but mine. This is a talk show, silly ass motherfucker. And if you want to ask me something, you pick up the motherfucking phone and call me and don't act like a bitch. Okay? Not bitch. You off my motherfucking page. Please understand, I don't dance to no motherfucking music but mine. Nobody but mine's. If you don't like what I do on my show, don't turn the motherfucker on. If you don't like my rules, go to another page. You can eat out of the depths of my ass. And if you sanctify Holy Ghost field, folk ain't never heard that, well, welcome to the Cussing Pastor Show. And I will not apologize for any damn thing I say. Now, anybody else want to go? Speak now or forever hold your peace. And I was going to try to be nice tonight because the saints are going to be here. The saints, I don't apologize now. Hallelujah. I don't apologize. It is what it is. Okay. Yeah. I told y'all I did not feel good when I come up there. I ain't the motherfucker y'all want to be fucking with this evening. You don't even get half a chance. I call my, as I stated to some of you who may not have been on there, I don't feel well worth a damn. I can't hear y'all. Well, something wrong with your ears. Yeah, that's why I said the fuck. I don't feel well. And I call my doctor. It's unusual for me to call my doctor. But I'm feeling real bad. And I'm going to fake the funk. So don't fuck with me. Okay. When I get off the air in the morning, I've got a doctor's appointment at 10:45. I'm going to jump in the car, drive over to the hospital. It'll be saved on Danny Great. It'll be saved on the YouTube. Okay. And I know that whatever this issue is that I'm going through right now has to do with two things, stress and my heart. So don't fuck with me. I don't care how holy, how fire baptized, the Holy Ghost believing you are. You might want to play with the devil other than play with me on tonight. 9 minutes after the hour, and again, I told Moses to make sure he called me. Darius Randall, you came to my other page. You're a real bitch. You didn't think I was gonna see you and put you off this page too? I'm a pastor that cuss? Yeah. And I'm a pastor that will fuck your mama if she good looking. Okay? And your little sister too. Just gonna get you off the page. Okay. Alright. See, any of you saints playing like you don't do nothing. I didn't fuck too many of you sisters at the holy convocations with your big hats on. I fucked one with a hat on. So don't pretend. Your bishop fucking sisters in the churches of God in Christ. Besides First Lady. Don't come to me with that holier than thou bullshit. You so heavenly, but you ain't no earthly good. I'm just real about who I am. Yeah, I fucked this. Sexy, I was a freak like that. I just wanted to fuck her with a big hat on. I fucked her till she started speaking in some tongues. Your bishops ain't all that. Your elders ain't all that. Do the corruption that is going on in your churches would not be going on. No, it was on that good. We put a stick pin in it. See, the church going to present preachers and those who hold titles. As above everybody else, there is no separate handbook for the preacher. The so-called man or woman of God versus the member. Here come a church person. Did I wash this mustache? Nope. Took it off. Put it back on. This shirt made me about $300 last night. Thank you, Jesus. And if you want to order the fuck t-shirt, you would order it right now. $25. Go to Cash App, $ Naked Truth Ministry. Get your mug. Get the other t-shirt. So yes, I wear it every day. And I ain't musty. I take baths, unlike your mammy. Shabba dabba do. You got yours, bad chick. Moses?
Hello?
I got you. Hold on a minute. All right. How are you doing this evening, sir?
Oh, I'm coming along. How are you doing?
I'm not feeling good, Moses, but I'm going to the doctor in the morning.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay. Well, yeah. I pray you feel better.
I pray
Can
that
you hear me clear?
Huh?
Can you hear me good?
Yeah. I pray that I feel better, too. I don't... My death would make a whole lot of folk happy.
Yeah, I sure would. Mm-hmm. But a lot of people would be sad too, because you try to enlighten people.
Well, I ain't worried about them. I'm trying to stay here for me.
Yes.
And nobody.
Well, you're not gonna go before it's your time.
I know. I just don't want the Lord to let my time come soon.
I know what that's like.
Because I'm trying to live for me and for me only. Hallelujah. Shabba dabba do and Yogi Bear too. All right. Let me get off into this show, Moses.
Yes, sir.
We've been dealing with this conflict or corruption in the leadership of the Church of God in Christ. I don't know how many years today.
Many, many years.
Yeah. I tried to go and pull some of the old stuff. But do you know I have over 800 emails from you?
Yes, and I have over 3,000 total.
Yes.
I kept a diary. So I just kept a diary.
Yeah, so I stopped at about 800. So I'm going to have to pull the emails up from your latest emails.
Yes, sir.
What started you on this crusade?
Oh, man. Well, as you know, I played the organ for different leaders, Bishop Patterson, Bishop Owens. I produced music for the church. And really in 1999, 2000, when they got together to get Bishop Owens out, the new co-chair of the leadership conference, Derek Hutchins, and Brandon, Bishop Porter, and some others, they spread the stuff on Bishop Owens that wasn't true. Namely, they had put out Bishop Hutchins, Derek Hutchins put out that Bishop Owens had broke up a funeral in a scheduled business meeting because they had put a dead body in there and put it on tape and stuff, and which wasn't true. I was there on the organ. He didn't break up those funerals. It was preposterous. But a lot of people believed it until after he died. You're starting to hear about it now.
So what?
That's what got me, sir.
So why did the leadership go after Bishop Owens, who came, I believe, after Bishop J.O. Patterson?
No, after Bishop Ford. Bishop.
All right. Bishop Ford.
After Bishop Ford.
All right. Bishop Ford came after J.O., right?
Right. Yes, sir.
And then after Bishop Ford was then Bishop Owens.
Bishop Owens. I played at Bishop Ford's banquet. And if you go on YouTube, I'm on there playing Yes, Lord, when they elected him to kiss his ring, and then Bishop Owens succeeded him. Those Bishop Owens and I had a great relationship, and that's when I went to Orlando, and that's when they got into that fiasco down there. And bottom line, it was so many untruths told and games told, and you know, some people stood, but very few, because we have a culture, even though people can know it's true, they don't have the courage to stand up. It's almost like they're gonna get whipped with a belt or something. I never seen nothing like it.
So is it standard in the Church of God in Christ that whatever the leadership of the church says, such as the bishop, the presiding bishop, is it taken for the gospel?
Yes. I think that people confuse elected positions with spiritual positions.
Okay.
There's, of course, a bishop is a spiritual office. My uncle was a bishop, like I told you last night. When I was born, then my cousin was made it all the way to the first assistant presiding bishop. So I've been knowing this all my life. But what happens is our culture teaches you don't question leadership. You disrespect the leadership. But the problem is we have a legal side of the church, our rules and regulations, because everybody don't always agree on how the scriptures interpret it. It's like a lot of people don't think I should talk to you. I said, well, if I can't talk to Pastor Thaddeus Matthews, because he's a custom preacher, then you need to go back in the Bible and deal with Joshua Spies. They say at a prostitute's operation there in Jericho, Rahab. They stay with a prostitute and saved their lives and then ended up marrying Rahab. So sometimes God uses who he chooses to get certain things done. So our culture, I know this is going to sound crazy, But I almost believe that some people in our culture that don't know no better, they, you can shoot somebody in Mason Temple, and if the leaders say don't call the police, they ain't gonna do it.
Okay, well.
That's the way we're, our culture is as far as leadership.
Okay, well, and let me remind those of you that's on my pages. If you all want to have a gathering and talk about where y'all gonna be, go to each other's pages. Not on my page. This is about this particular show and this particular show at all. Y'all be friends on y'all pages, okay? Moses, with so much to talk about, where do you want to start?
Well, first, I think I want to start by thanking your audience for many years, and you supported my music and stuff even before we met, and I appreciate you. I appreciate you enlightening people on different subjects for many, many, many years. I appreciate that. I want to start with, first, I thank God for just being here. I almost died last November, as I told you. Mm-hmm. I ended up having to have open heart surgery. I couldn't breathe, that is. And so I thought maybe I got COVID. It was on the year anniversary of my brother's death. You know, he died in his sleep a year before. And I couldn't breathe. And the ambulance got to the house, and I collapsed in the yard. And the last thing I heard that man said, we lose, I think I sent you a picture of me. And I had to go on life support. A couple of days later, I came to, and the heart surgeon standing over my bed. And he told me what was going on, and I told him, okay, go ahead on to do it. And God left me here. Man, I started on a journey that I'll tell you better another time. Mm-hmm. But I'll just leave it so far to tell you this. There's so much more beyond this planet. So my attitude now is I'm just biding my time. My two brothers is gone. My father's gone. So my decisions is more made towards what makes sense or that's going to contribute to the people. Because the people have been great to me.
I'm having some breathing issues that I picked up in the last week or so. And it got so bad today that most folks that know me know I ain't just volunteering going to the doctor. I called my doctor and told him I need to see you in the morning. I know it's late this evening, but I need to see you first thing in the morning. So I'm going in the morning, man, to see what's going on with me. I have been feeling pretty good since I went to see the doctor and they did whatever procedure that they were supposed to do to me. But in the last couple of weeks, I've been feeling bad. And I got to use some sense. I got to get some of this stress off me. And I just got to do what I got to do to live. Hell, I'm 64. And I decided I won't stay here 64 more.
Well, you can have it. I don't. But you can have it.
Well, you go on to that other place then. And send me an email.
Let me tell you something. Let me tell you, I'm serious about that. I'm telling you, you remember I told you. But back to what you'd asked me. Mm-hmm. So I want to just say that. Now, here's where I am now. As you know, 3 years ago, I interviewed with you, and Bishop Porter called you on one particular case, especially the Houston case. Well, now we have more evidence that I can prove that they have engaged in fraud, and is yet engaged in fraud in that case. But that's just one case, and there's a bigger issue to me that I want to discuss with you in ministry, period. I want to first go on record and tell you, it's not the church. The people don't even know what's going on. If you look at my thread, it's only about 75 names on there because I've been trying to give them a chance, the management, to change course. So it's maybe only about 20, 25 people we need to get rid of if they won't get off this path now because it's going to drag down the organization.
So
it's about 25 people, Pastor Matthews, that's directly involved in some decision-making that is basically engaging in fraud, grand theft, and abuse in Houston. That's one case, and I can prove all this, as you know, with documentation. So that's where I'm coming from, and I'm being very direct to what I'm saying.
All right.
Our general board is supposed to uphold the laws of the church and biblical principles. They are not doing that in the Houston case. And if they don't do it, they need to be impeached. It ain't personal.
So who are the 25 leaders that need to go?
I got to finish my list, but Chairman Thuston have charges against him. because he hides information from the General Assembly. He hid information that would have freed Bishop Cowles that he's yet hiding, where Chief Justice Johnson, who is going to be the new General Counsel, he brought charges against the Chief Judiciary Board, Justice Bishop Johnson, for issuing basically fraudulent rulings against Bishop Cowles. And the General Board knew it, and they still defrocked him. They yet defrocked him. So now all that's coming back around. That's that big red box that you made. And Bishop Porter and them knew this. That's why I asked Bishop Porter to feel free to come on with me, because he's the one that told you to step up Bishop Cowles. But 3 years later, I'm saying that they are engaging in fraud tonight. We have rulings from the Board of Bishops Grievance Committee that he was supposed to be reinstated as pastor January 2020. And he didn't sit 6 years or so. He's owed over $1,700,000.
Now, how is he owed over $1 million?
Because they took the money that he would have been getting during the suspension, and Bishop Blake sent a letter in 2016 that he was supposed to still get his money until everything was resolved. I could send the letter. So, because you got to remember, he was not convicted. He was on suspension.
So, wait a minute.
Nobody else like that to my knowledge.
So, does the bishops get a salary?
The general board gets a salary. You know, two offerings, you know, it depends on what their setup is. It depends on the size, depends on the setup. Like in our national church, the general board gets a salary. I think it's like $55,000 a year or something like that.
Yeah, but most of those guys are millionaires too.
Well, I mean, it depends. I mean, I don't know. But the point is, they do get a salary for their jobs. So the chairman of the general assembly gets a salary. So they get salaries.
Let me ask you this. Is it the rule of the church that whenever a bishop goes and speaks at a church, there's a certain amount of an honorarium that they're supposed to receive?
Well, I don't think it's a set amount. I think people give what they can afford to give. Some jurisdictions are smaller than others. So, of course, if your leaders come, we're going to do the best we can for them because, you know, out of respect, we respect that.
So
that's different. Is
the average offering about $5,000?
It depends on who it is. Very few people get that to go speak. So it depends on who it is.
So
I
then
mean, I've been with leaders that picked up. It depends on where it was. Sometimes you pick up maybe $10,000. It just depends on where you are and what the people want to do.
So
but see, in our church, like this is a general board. If a bishop dies, if the general board members go, they get an honorarium. So if it's a small jurisdiction, sometimes they don't want to see them coming because they got to scrape up some money, man.
Plus, they got to fly me in and pay hotel rooms, right?
To my understanding, that's a setup. I used to talk to my cousin Bishop Haynes about that. To me, that was too rough.
So if you get $55,000 across the table, you're getting hundreds of thousands of dollars under the table.
Well, I wouldn't say it like that, but the average general board bishop is also a jurisdictional bishop and a pastor. So it's not his only income.
So, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I need to understand this before I go further. So if you are on the general board, you get a salary. If you're a jurisdictional bishop, you get a salary, and if you're the pastor of the church, you get a salary.
Oh yeah, or you get whatever they give. Yes.
Shit, I knew I should have went.
If you go to a funeral of a bishop, you're gonna get an honorarium. So they're gonna get an honorarium.
Shit, I knew I should have went to Kojic years ago.
Well, I think what happened is Bishop Cowles had a wealthy jurisdiction. I didn't get involved until 2016, 2017. So they was already 3 years in or so pilfering that account. In fact, when I went there a few years ago to deal with it, we went to Wells Fargo Bank with me and Ellen McClure. When the lady found out Bishop was the CEO, he was still listed, but he was only on suspicion. She told Bishop Cowles he needed to go to the police to report what was going on. They even shut down his jurisdiction account, Thaddeus, before they had defrocked him. And they can't get no accounting. right now they can't get no accounting from that jurisdiction. So me and Bishop Porter got into it because he was over that area. And once I started inquiring because I was getting calls, his answers to me were just honest. And when he knew that we had a deal for Bishop Cowles, he tried to destroy the jurisdiction along with the general board anyway. And now Bishop Cowles has been defrocked. They won't get out of his local church, and the general board have no business in a local church matter. And I sent the letter to you so you can read it. Bishop Blake told us to deal with the last matter. He got clear, and they are yet in his local church trying to allow it to be pilfered. And won't say nothing now, and telling different stories of different people saying we're in negotiations. We're not in negotiations. And so the bottom line is, I want to make sure I'm clear. We are having a fraudulent situation that's going on right now that the general board is involved in. And I challenge any one of them to say I'm lying to you. Well, that's based on the documents that you have. And that you'll...
You know, I got so many documents, I don't know where to start.
I'll make sure you get them. Well, you can just post them.
Well, just tell me where I need to go. I'm looking at this document that you sent me. Let me make it a while up. It's got all of these jurisdictions on it, and it's got all of these bishops' name on it. Then it's got male, female, laity, and total. What is that?
That's our credential report.
And what is that? What is that, Moses?
Well, like, we pay reports for our credentials. Like, I get, mine is $400. You remember Bishop Porter told you that time I couldn't get in because I didn't want to pay my elder's report, which was only $150. He knew that wasn't true.
Okay.
So that's our report. We pay that once a year. And that's what you see. Give it to the bishop, or either we can go into a system and pay it. And it's a credit to the jurisdiction, to my understanding.
So what
so that's what you're looking at.
So what does a credential stand for that you got to pay $400 for?
Well, really, it ain't like you can get discounts on coffee or nothing, I don't think. But you need your credentials in order to get on the general assembly floor. If you want to say something or vote or whatever, you must be credentialized. And then, of course, it's a way to also support the church. So they use that money to undergird the expenses of the church, which are in serious question now because we can't get no honest answers. We get to the general assembly, basically, the people be tired, sleep, because the average age is over 60, because I'm 60 now. So just think, a guy like me come to Memphis, Chairman Thuster don't send us the information 10 days like the law said we're supposed to get. So when we get there, that's when we find out what the general board and other people have done, and they asked us to vote up or down. See, the presiding bishop and the general board is in charge of the church when we are in recess. The ruling body is the general assembly. So they make the decisions when we are in recess. So right now, Bishop Shear is in charge of the church as CEO. When the general assembly, when the general board and him are together, he can make the decisions, they make the decisions. Then they got to come back and tell us in our next session, Pastor Matthews, what decisions did they make? So if they done stuff illegal and Chairman Thuston hides it and don't send the information out, the general assembly will vote to go along with it because they don't know they've been defrauded.
So what is looking at these credential numbers, where does this money go? Who's
to
over
the
this?
National Church Treasury.
And who's over the National Church?
To the banks.
Huh?
We have a National Treasurer. We have a Financial Secretary. Like any corporation, they are supposed to be custodial of the money. To my understanding, that's where it's supposed to be. We vote for the treasurer.
So I'm looking at the grand totals 2021 through 2022. $3,502,294.12.
I think it's a little more than that. Ain't it $4 million? I'm not looking at
it. I'm looking at the first line. Where it says male, Over on the last line is $4,884,165.79. Grand total 2020 through 21 is $6,029,534.19.
Right, I think, I mean, whatever the numbers say, that's what they are. So that goes into the national church to do business, to pay bills. Now, exactly what bills, I'm not sure, because I've never seen a readout. So we don't get a report to say where the money went.
So
we get a general, we get a generality. So I want to make sure I'm saying this accurately.
Okay.
I don't think we get total clear understanding of where things are. I know that superintendent and a couple of friends of mine requested to see financial information the way the law requires, and it was ignored. In fact, they asked for information a couple of years ago, and they were flatly denied. So you know, nonprofit organizations are supposed to have so many years worth of records on the premises. We ain't got no response. And the reason why I did is because they've accused Bishop Blake of a lot of stuff that I don't believe he's done. And I said, the way you could clear it up, just show our records. True records. And the numbers that they do show, they be so small, you need almost a microscope, one of them scopes to see. But I don't want to waste too much time on that. What I'm saying to you is the bottom line, we need to revamp a lot of stuff in our church. And so what brought me back up for air is they refuse to just follow the rulings internally that have been favored to Bishop Cowles. They will not get out of his local church. And they know that the ministry has been ripped off. They know all of this, and they yet refuse to obey our law. So we're going to have to deal with impeachment and, of course, the legal system. But, that takes a while with COVID and all. So let me tell you the games they play.
Okay.
They don't mind the lawsuit because they use the saints' money to defend it. So they think they can play with Bishop Cowles another 2 or 3 years playing in court, and he's 79 years old. We're not waiting for that. I mean, that's part of it. But what they have been doing, Pastor, is engaging in crimes. Fraud is a crime. And I know it's fraud because I took them to the table. And after I got them to do what I was asked to do, all this is in writing, they shafted us. The Board of Bishops Executive Committee, Chairman Thuston involved, the General Board, and others. And I can work on the names, and you can upload the names.
So which one?
And it's a disgrace.
Which one of these emails you want me to start on first?
But I don't know which one you have in front of you.
Well, I closed that one that had all that down. I got so damn many. You sent me one today concerning, who is Kimberly Pollard?
Miss Pollard is a young lady that was, that's the story of a bishop that they was, I guess, doing what they was doing when she was 16, and it went on for a while. It ended up at the Board of
Bishops. Wait a minute. What happened to her when she was 16?
Well, according to the article, if you read it, in her stipulations, they started having sex.
Wait a minute. That ain't, wait a minute, Jesus. No. Wait a minute.
I'm not laughing, though. But what made me laugh is they're trying to destroy people, and they promoted.
Who is she having sex with?
One of the bishops in the Church of God in Christ.
That would ain't.
And she got a judgment. Sorry.
Oh, wait a minute. I'm trying to find that particular email.
Yeah, there's a story on it. That's a New York company did a story on it. I was part of the interview. And she was trying to work it out. They was trying to work it out. But unfortunately, again, the Board of Bishops Executive Committee, they botched it. And she was under the impression that I was trying to undermine her, which I wasn't. I was working with the bishop, hopefully, was trying to get a resolution that dealt with the whole thing. Well, the board of bishops of the church got a judgment against it because they missed some dates for $750.
Okay.
Well, ultimately, they told the courts that they're not responsible. This is my interpretation of it, that they're not responsible for the actions of the bishop. So the court didn't know no better. A lawyer at the time who's died said he didn't know church law that they are responsible. How can you not be responsible for the bishop and you took down cows?
All right. Who was this? Wait a minute. Let me go back to this young girl.
Yes, sir.
Her name is Paula,
Emma,
right?
Paula. Yes, sir.
What's the name of the bishop that was having sex with her when she was 16?
His name is Bishop Keith Jones.
Of what church?
In New Mexico. In fact, he prayed over our elections that we had a couple months ago, that we may have to have new elections because if we got so many problems right now with the allegations of credential tampering in the ARC system. But anyway, that's another subject. We'll go back to that later.
So how?
He's in New Mexico.
How did they find out that, was he a bishop?
Yeah, not when they started out. When they started out, it was young. He was young.
So,
I mean, she has a story. That's who you need to interview. And I said from the standpoint that the National Church wouldn't pay for counseling for her. They wouldn't pay the judgment. They tricked the court to get out the judgment. So now she's having to go back again. And I went to them. I even wrote to the women's department and asked them, why don't they reach out to her and the young lady? See, because another lady called me, Thaddeus. She had a problem. The men was messing with her at the church and women. And I reached out.
Wait a minute. Now, not the evangelist. Yes, not the evangelist. Not the evangelist sisters. They weren't trying to get the girl too, were they?
The young lady is on the East Coast called me, and she had a sad story. And we finally got that worked out. I think the National Church believed it and settled. But she had a problem with a couple of the deacons, and then one of the youth leaders was trying to have sex with her. And, it was a mess. So I suggested to the National Church officials, we need to set up some kind of a committee, hotlines or something, to show that we have an interest in sexual abuse allegations. And to date, to my knowledge, we still don't have.
The bishops and the one Neil Bynums and all of them, they just going after the young girls.
Well, I don't know, but what disturbed me about our official is they trying to destroy Bishop Cowles for less allegations. And then, Pastor Matthews, they are recently spreading new rumors on him, trying to act like he was messing with minors. That's not true. So it put me in a position, because I represent Bishop, because I took him to the table. He has a lawyer for court. But see, the lawyer can only write to the general counsel. So I can talk to the church. So they spreading rumors on him. Mr. Porter spreading lies and tearing out, said he never repented, which he did. He's trying to tell people why he kept his pastor at a church that allegedly had sex in the church office with another woman.
No.
The woman is mounting him. Mounting him?
In the office?
And that's what the picture is. It was sent because, you remember, Bishop Porter was interfering with our interview. And he told somebody, to my understanding recently, he let him stay there because people wanted him, and he repented, he did all that. Well, then he says the bishop never repented, never did any of that. Bishop never did any of that, let alone have church in the local church office.
Wait a minute.
So now bishop has paid his dues, lies and rumors.
You
having sex in the office.
You got to give
sex.
Me. You have to
sex,
give
sex,
you,
sex.
Sex. You have to give me.
Yes.
You have to give me moments to come in here.
Yes, sir.
He was having sex in the office of his church.
I sent you the picture.
I ain't get the picture. You need to send me.
You just don't remember. I'll send it to you again.
Send it to me again. Because
they're having sex in the office. And he's yet in this church, and I'm not trying to kill her, them. I'm just talking about the hypocrisy.
How come he didn't lock the door?
Thank you.
And the sister was mounting him? That was Bishop who?
He's not a bishop. I'll send you the picture. I think his name is on the is on the picture.
No.
The officials got it. And I only point this out because they're trying to destroy Bishop Cowles. He wasn't accused of stuff like that. We got general board members just went to another bishop that was accused of raping three women.
At the church?
Celebrated years of being a bishop for 20 years. That was just a couple of months ago. Some of the general board members, the same members that are engaging in fraud with Bishop Cowles. And I'm prepared to lift my hand in the court and swear on the Bible, affirm my statement, that they are engaging in fraud. They don't care about the victims. They didn't have no banquet for the victims. And I don't have nothing against the bishop that I'm referred to. I'm only pointing out the hypocrisy. And then one of the bishops that's dealing with this and sitting back quiet watching this, he used to take the church money, tithes, and offerings. And hire prostitutes.
No, man.
Yeah, and God redeemed him. And God brought him back, man. Preaching the gospel. Cleaned him up. Did everything. And he won't stand for what's right with me.
He
came out to Los Angeles to spend a week with me doing his rehabilitation. And God rehabbed him too. And now he won't stand with me and say, hey, let's just follow the law. The man done suffered enough.
And he was taking the church money and buying prostitutes.
That's my understanding. And if I got any part of it wrong, he's welcome to correct me because I want to be accurate. But my point is, he's part of the executive committee and he know they shafted Bishop Cowles and shafted Miss Pollard. That's my testimony. I'm giving it after me. And I love this man. So let me be clear. God can redeem you. And I know that. Now, if he was buying prostitutes, that's not like having sex with minors. I mean, it's bad. But depending on what state he in, I don't know if that's a crime. But he's quiet. See, and now the board, I mean, the bottom line is we got a rogue operation that needs to be ran. And as you can see, I've been saying it for 4 years. And I think they think being silent makes it go away. It doesn't make it go away.
But man, I'm just surprised at all the hypocrisy.
That we're not honest with the people, and it's not culture. This is as a people. I believe we should challenge each other to righteousness. And if one of us fall, we should be there to try to bring you back. I don't mean your position, per se. Bring you back as a brother or a sister. Mm-hmm. Don't try to destroy me to take what you think is or spoils and split it among people who have been accused of having sex with men in the bed, being caught by their wives, and participating in orgies and everything else.
Don't do that. Don't throw these words in there and just keep on going. They ain't having no orgies in the Church of God in Christ, is it?
Well, it's not in the Church of God in Christ, but some people in the Church of God in Christ, Montana, and I want to be accurate. I've written before how many sexual payouts have we had, because the people have a right to know, because the money belongs to the organization, and they will not respond. Mm. So my point is to this, I'm calling on the general board and them, let's not the foolishness. The chairman of the pastor's elders council, he's tried to interfere with a ruling that he know was legally done. Now, nothing changed the ruling. Bishop Cowles was supposed to be reinstated and made whole. And that was a phony trial that we just followed up on. They still won't get out. I don't have nothing against the chairman, but he's wrong. And we got to have another election because, listen to this, we just had an election to get new officers in the pastor's elders council. I presided, Bishop Shear just said, we had 12,000 pastors. not including the elders. The election was held, to my understanding, Pastor Matthews, less than 350 people participated in the pastors and elders election. You know why? Because, in my opinion, it was suppressed. So a lot of people didn't even know what it was. So you got officers in position, to my understanding, less than 400 or 500 votes out of 12,000 that could be eligible. But they don't have the election on the main day. They have the election some side time. So we need to do that all over again.
So what, I need a drink. Where y'all going from here?
Well, some people should go to jail. Like I did. They had me arrested.
They had you arrested for what?
Said I was making threats and they thought I don't even own the gun. I went to Houston 3 times. They came around the corner and got me, but they didn't want to do it at the church. Every time I went there, they had off-duty cops trying to stop me going in. Of course, I went in. Because they're stealing the money and everything else. And the general board knows this. And they say nothing. This has been going on for years. The Board of Bishops Grievance Committee charged Kirk Thompson with financial irregularities. He pleaded guilty, but we still can't get the records. And they yet letting him carry on.
Moses, do they still let you play in the Church of God in Christ?
Oh, yeah, because well, I haven't been traveling because of COVID, then I had my surgery, so. But you have to understand, my talent took me beyond coaching. So I don't depend on that. Listen to me. The average pastor don't even know what's going on, that's what I'm trying to tell you. They're going to find out now because this is going to a much higher level. So the bottom line is, like Brandon, Mr. Portman, he know I'm told the truth. I went to them in private, Bishop, and bade them change course. I had a meeting with him in a hotel room in Atlanta in 2018, bade them to change course. And he refused to do it. So we have a system that they do what they want to do, they break laws, and they know nobody's going to really challenge them. People be scared to talk to you. That's how scary these people are. And they know I'm telling the truth.
Well,
so we need to, in my opinion, come to the table and let's just clean this stuff up because it's not going nowhere. Well, and the reason why I can't let it go, I'm the one took the deal to Bishop Cowles. So they used me to get him to cooperate. And then after I got him to cooperate, they wouldn't even return my calls. And I could prove everything I'm telling. They engaged in fraud. And it's yet going on. Fraud, grand theft, and abuse. And they should be ashamed of themselves.
Well, we know Brandon is not going to call me on the air and speak on this. And Brandon, if you have, if you're watching this, Brandon, you have my personal numbers. So you more than welcome to call in any bishop or leader in the Church of God in Christ that want to say, and I'm sure that there are many leaders in the Church of God in Christ that's presently watching this program. If you want to call, the number is area code 901-231-9239. But I don't really think that is going to happen. Okay. Yes.
I want to go on record with this too. Bishop Cowles will tell you he has no financial arrangement with me, nor to Miss Pollard. Bishop Cowles just happened to it came into my orbit because of another situation, and I was trying to help him resolve his case because it went so many years. And he wanted to take responsibility for some of the things that he had done, and he cooperated. And when they took that, they brought another case against him and took this thing and said, now he admitted to this, admitted to that. And then Brandon Porter, at the same time, lied to the Board of Bishops and said he never repented. I got that in writing in the minutes. After they threw Bishop Cowles out, he thought he was going to get his paperwork, Pastor Matthews, in 2017, I think it was. So I told him to go because the paperwork was just late, because the chairman said everything got to be done by May. Well, it was a Dodge. So I told him to go in July. Paperwork is just late. When he gets there, Chairman,
Glenn Cheek,
they threw him out of the session. Mm-hmm. And Brandon got up and lied, told the people he didn't repent, he didn't do that. And his repenting and stuff was in writing. That's what they've done to this man. And now they're spreading rumors, keep on going. And they got signatures from members that forgave him and want him back. And they out lying, saying the people don't want him. They're doing that right now.
Do you think that, excuse me, do you think that Bishop Cowles will speak to me?
Oh, I'm sure I probably can get him to speak to you. I'll reach out and see. And let me tell you what's so sad about this.
Mm-hmm.
The bottom line is, I know they're trying to cover up. See, when you become pastor again, get back in position, all the final records are official years, and it's easier to do this. But he still could do it anyway if they keep stalling. But I will speak to him. But that's what they did to that man. He's not a fighter like that. That is, not only not a fighter, he is more like a following figure, and they try to humiliate him, make him sit on the front row in his own church for the last 6 years. Don't even let him testify. Mr. Blake sent a letter with the general board in 2016. He's supposed to get his money. They ain't giving him a dime. I went down there, and we had a special service for him. They didn't send a nickel to support him. And what's really frustrating me about this, some of these men that's doing this are whoremongers themselves.
Mm.
Known whoremongers.
All whoremongers.
And I'm not trying to do that. And what I like about Bishop Cowles, he never tried to say, hey, well, they did this, so I should. He never did that. He took his punishment that. And then when his time was up and we did things, they kept on turning the straw. Right now, his jurisdiction is in limbo because they tried to tear it up while he was on suspension. Now, that ain't working because they didn't legally transfer out the jurisdiction. It's about 100-some churches. That's why I said we're going to need new elections if we keep going, because the credentials of the churches that they try to create new jurisdictions are not legal. They didn't vote out.
Okay.
And I challenge any general board member to say I'm lying to you. Any one of them. So how can we have fair elections if the credentials are not pure? And let me leave this with you. They're yet making auxiliary bishops when the judiciary board rule don't do that no more until we get amendments. We've been asking to see the lifting of the injunction, and they have the final say of the judiciary board. We haven't seen a copy yet. I think they made 40 more bishops or 30-some bishops do the inauguration. So they're not obeying our laws.
Well, let me ask you this. With this type of hypocrisy going on in the church, all of these lawsuits that you have filed, why do the folks keep on giving them money?
Well, listen to this. A lot of them don't know what's filed because Chairman Tilston, at least what I can remember, they're not giving no report per se on these lawsuits and what the facts are. I mean, my own mama's church got raped. We had a trial date. I pulled back because in the last minute, they lied and said they didn't know what the actual numbers was that we was saying. So I said, okay, we'll withdraw without prejudice. And let's take 120 days, come to the table and see what we do. Well, they didn't come to the table. We didn't refile, but they can refile. They didn't care about the financial abuse in question. They came hard on us. In fact, Attorney Henderson, who now is the bishop of the air, he's a bishop. He used to be general counsel. He told lies on me in writing, him and this little old lying lawyer in Beverly Hills, and made it about me when I wasn't there. I was just speaking up for my mom's church because they had been promised a parking lot and lied to by the then pastor.
Okay.
Well, they didn't care about the hurt of the church. Even the first assistant or second assistant at the time, Bishop Macklin, gave a deposition. But in the end, he didn't come back and say, hey, y'all, let's just put in measures for checks and balances. Well, the reason why I think they don't do that is because the National Church ain't got no serious checks and balances. And the fact that they're allowing Bishop Cowles' church to be raped like this, they got a person in there with a felony record. Went to prison, to my understanding, for Social Security card fraud. That's the administrator now. They had me arrested. still in there.
So
they don't care about checks and balances.
So
in this church don't mean nothing.
So are you saying that there are some crooks at the helm?
Are there what?
Crooks, thieves, rogues.
There is a culture of people who are not obeying the laws and biblical principles. The average pastor don't even have a salary. Let me be clear. The average pastor go out and get a loan, borrow money. My daddy, he dead now. When he got his church, you know they wasn't giving black churches bank loans and stuff. That he got some people up, they have pooled money to get the down payment, got the church. Paid the church off 10 years early. The average pastor and coaching may have 50 members or so. They bury their dead. They counsel people. They wouldn't hurt a fly. It's a batch of hustlers that have got into positions in our organization and management stuff. They need to be thrown out. They have no integrity. Some of the biggest liars I've ever encountered. And I come up with a lot of them. And the reason why I have no fear of them, because if I want to be at that level, I could have been. I didn't chase to be a bishop and all that. No. I was satisfied with, and I'm convinced that is God set me aside to do what you see me doing. I used to anger Reverend Justice Jackson a lot. Somebody have to have a compassion for people. Am I perfect? No. So you can challenge me on something. But to hurt people deliberately in the church, that's wrong. And that's not just a culture problem. That happens in a lot of things, but we're talking about culture now. So I want you to know, the average pastor, they wouldn't hurt nobody. These people give money, they won't even really ask questions. My daddy raised us. If they ask money, give it. If you ain't got it all, give what you can and shut your mouth. Don't try to discourage other people. But we got to have checks and balances. And I love Bishop Porter. I keep calling this thing because he's the one that invoked you in this business. Is that not correct?
The cows. Lady is calling me.
The who?
The young lady, Yesenia Kyles. Hold on.
Okay.
Hello?
Yesenia Kyles. To accept, press 1.
Ms. Kyles, good evening.
Hi, how you doing?
I am fine. Wait a minute, I want to merge you. Let me sit back. Lord have mercy, I don't be knowing what the hell I'm doing. I'm old. I want to merge you with Moses Tyson.
Okay, that's my brother.
Okay. Let's do this. I'm hitting that. Wait a minute. Add call.
I need to mute my PC, don't I? I need to mute my YouTube.
Wait a minute. Are you there?
I'm here.
Moses?
Hey, it's Ezra.
She had to bail
me out of jail when I got arrested. I'll send you that. I was in jail 18 hours, Pastor Matthews. And guess what the sister told me? 19 hours. Guess she's an attorney. Guess what? The National Church need her skills. Guess she walked around that courtroom and she told me, don't you say nothing. Okay. But I was in jail for 19 hours. And guess what she told me when they finally bailed me out at like 3 o'clock in the morning?
What?
She said, well, do you want to just go and stay down there since you got to see the judge about 9 o'clock with the traffic and everything?
You see?
And my poor mother, she was like about to cry when they were taking me off. I was handcuffed. I'll send you the videotape.
Okay. Let me.
And the general board didn't care nothing about me being arrested.
No, they didn't. Let me get, Yeshida, am I pronouncing it correctly?
Yesenia.
Okay, close enough. What's going on with you and the Church of God in Christ?
So, there's nothing going on with me. I don't know if you know this, but Bishop Kyles is my father.
Okay.
The reason I wanted to talk to you tonight was just to...
And I need you to speak up I need you to speak up just a little bit louder for me.
Okay, I put you off speakerphone. Is that better?
That's better. That's
okay. So I just wanted to call in and thank my brother, Moses Tyson, because there are so many people who have latched on to my father's coattail over the years. Yes. My dad could not go to the restroom without somebody running in behind him. But since all this mess has been going on, we can't find one person to stand in the gap with him.
Okay.
Maybe one or two people. Maybe one or two people. But when I tell you Moses has been on the front line, and he has done what nobody else in Houston has done, I just want to let you know on behalf of my family that our hats are off to him. Because he didn't know us. I mean, he had been to the convocation once, but he don't even remember sitting right next to me at the convocation. He came on a ministry assignment. But he is the only person who has stood in the gap and who has stood up for my father through all this corruption. So, and I just want to make it publicly known that I appreciate him for that.
Ms. Cowles,
Ms. Cowles,
what actually happened with your father in the Church of God in Christ?
Well, I mean, Moses has pretty much already addressed that part. I can't get into any specific details because I was one of the attorneys on the case.
Okay.
But the reality is, what has happened is that whatever his situation was, it is minuscule compared to anything else that has happened. Now, one thing I don't think Moses has mentioned is the fact that when we first came to that church in 1986, mm-hmm. it was only a few years after that that we paid that mortgage off.
Okay.
So you're talking about a mortgage-free property.
Right.
And that's the difference in my dad's church and the church in New Mexico where Bishop right. Lakeith Jones is. They don't want that church. They don't want to do anything with Lakeith Jones because if they got rid of him, then who's going to
pay? They got the mortgage.
We burnt that mortgage 30 years ago at Evangelist Temple.
Now, let me ask you this about the protocol of the Church of God in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Even though your father and the congregants of that church paid mm-hmm. off the mortgage, is that property the property of the Church of God in Christ International?
It's no. Let me be clear with this. That's what we got to deal with. It is, and it isn't. Let me say it this way.
Right,
it's supposed
right.
to be held in trust for the use of the member of the Church of God in Christ, which makes sense, and it's a non-profit building.
Okay.
But members don't have no investment in that building, and they want to come take it and give it to somebody. That's why we need to go to court so we can clean all this old scoundrel stuff up. And then when the church get in trouble and you call for help, you can't get them on the phone. So they'll take her daddy's church and give it to a scoundrel. And when you call them and they're in trouble, they ain't going to return your call.
What was your father the founder of the ministry?
No, he wasn't the founder. The founder was
Nelson,
Pastor Joe Nelson.
Okay.
And so my father, Pastor Joe Nelson, passed away not long after the church was completed.
Okay.
And I had just did a revival with him, ironically, right. with Horace Ross, not knowing I would be going back to that church for this. That's only 35, 40 years ago, Thaddeus.
So the church was only, what, maybe 2 years old when we went there?
Okay.
That's correct. And he died. Joe Nelson died.
Right.
He had just built a church. Oh, wait, here's right. an example of what I'm telling you. You know what? Joe Nelson even borrowed his insurance policy to help build that church.
Okay.
That's the kind of pastor that we had. They okay. loved the church.
Okay. Okay.
So they want to take that building, the control of that building, and give it to somebody else. After Bishop have done everything they said, and we got another problem. Bishop is the CEO, according to the Texas tax ID and all that stuff. They went and changed registered agent, opened up bank accounts and stuff, but he's still on the tax ID as the CEO, so they have broken the laws.
How did they change the registration with the state?
It's easy. I'm gonna be honest with you, Thaddeus. If you wanted to make yourself the registered agent in Texas, you could send in a form to the Texas Secretary of State and just put your name on it. It's easy to do.
And they don't check anything.
They don't check anything. We have changed it back and forth several times.
That way, and the man that put his name on, not even a member, he's a man that Brandon Porter left when he got ran out of town. Called himself administrative pastor. I know he put his name down there on Williams Temple. He got charges on him right now that Chairman Thurston is hiding. But he had charges on him. The man died. The charges kept going. Deacon McAdams asked him to help him because they ignored him for a year. Thurston said he was going to run it through. Bishop Porter had him come preach for him. While the charges on the desk, he preached for him at the convocation. And he never brought them charges for it again, despite written promises. They're still sitting there right now. That's why Bishop Thurston have charges against him now.
This is the issue I have with Bishop Porter. Well, this is one of the issues. I have many. But one of the issues that I have with him is the fact that he came to the church. Well, actually, the meeting was held at Williams Temple with the Evangelist Temple Church members. And the statement of allegations that came out against my dad, they read that statement of allegations at least 8 times. They read it before the church services. They read it at the convocation. They read it at AIM. Every time they got my dad in a large setting, they read that statement of allegations. When we had that meeting at Williams Temple that night, my dad said to Brandon, he said, "Now with the same fervency that you are reading this statement of allegations, will you promise me that once this is reversed, you will come back with that same energy and read the reversal document?" Brandon said, "Absolutely." And he absolutely did not do that. I have no respect for him at all. That's Moses' brother. That's not my brother. I have no
respect. Well, he's my brother, but he's my brother.
He's a liar. He is a liar.
He's a big one.
And I'm going to leave it at a liar because I have some other adjectives that I could use, but I won't because I'm on the show. And so, I got to try to make sense.
We use them adjectives on my show.
Oh, Lord. Wait, Pastor Matthews, listen to this. Stay here, Yesidra. So let me be clear with you. 2017, I have officials come to me. Can you get Bishop to consider this just not having a retrial and we just settle on it? I got Bishop to sign the document against his attorney's advice because they want the paperwork simultaneously. Right, Cassandra?
Right. That's right.
I told Bishop we can't wait on that. We got to get this over with because Chairman Shear said everything needs to be done and they got to make sure you're really going to do this and blah, 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 blah. Bishop Gals told his lawyers, "I'm going with Moses." And let me tell you why he did it. And let me tell you why he did it, Thaddeus, because we made a pact that he was going to go around and encourage young men and stuff, don't get caught up around no women or no circumstances, be careful. That's why I can't drop this man. And then he repented in writing. I had a general board bishop member beg me to let him go. Don't fight for him no more. I told him I could not do that. Now, maybe you can, but I can't do that. So I'm saying to our general board, we'll never be blessed as an organization as long as we are engaged in this type of hypocrisy, fraud, no concern for sexual victims. The little boy said he was passed around, I think, at 13, and God allowed the lawyer, who's a Catholic lawyer that got 700 clients, me and him became friends.
Wait. Stop. Sometimes you go so fast. Moses.
I'm sorry, I get a little bit of my medication.
Who was passing a 13?
Oh, no, you didn't.
Who was passing a 13-year-old boy around?
Some cultic preachers. That was the allegation. So they filed a lawsuit against the church. And so the lawyer, his name is Attorney Servant. He knew my brother. Look him up. He was one of the lawyers that broke through the Catholic priest. He had 700 Catholic clients. He's also a writer and he do forums. We're supposed to do some forums together, but of course it's COVID and I've been sick. Anyway, he represents a young man that the allegations was he was passed around having sex with older preachers and stuff, I think starting at the age of 13 or 14.
Wait a minute. In the Church of God in Christ?
Yes. So when they made the allegations and filed the lawsuit, The spokesman said we have no comments at that time. So, of course, that's the natural thing. Well, I waited and said, well, we should have comments. Our comments should at least be that we're going to look into these allegations, look into the well-being of the accuser, and we're going to put in measures to deal with this for the future. They have not done that yet. I begged them. We need to set up something for sexual
Wait a minute. 700 victims where?
In the Catholic Church.
Oh, okay.
Attorney Sullivan, he won cases for 700 victims.
Okay. So how many victims of rape and molestation and pedophiles are there in the Church of God in Christ?
We don't know, because
we don't know.
I know that more cases are coming. I told the General Board that. I told him that we need to put in some measures. So I would think that at least you'll show that you have some concern, especially for the young women and stuff. But no. So, I mean, so we're not just cultic bats. I'm telling you, we just need to, we can't just keep shouting and dancing. Shouting and dancing, okay. When we get through shouting and dancing, we're going to have to protect these young women.
No, y'all get through having shouting and dancing, then y'all going to have orgies and stuff and mess with the little boys and the little girls.
No, it's wrong. I mean, I think it should be much more aggressive. But no, we're making more and more bishops.
Moses and Pastor Matthew, this is my thing. The punishment needs to fit the crime.
Okay.
And in my father's case, the punishment did not fit the crime.
Right. If they never done nobody like that.
No. And they have tried, I have sat back and watched them as they have tried to literally kill not just my dad, but my mom too. Because, of course, my family. Because if my father is affected, we're all affected.
Mm-hmm. Wait, now a brother can't go in church on Sundays after they got a ruler in their favor. He's an ordained elder, chairman of the trustee board. They got off-duty cop there saying he can't come in now. And the general board won't say a word. And Bishop Brian live in Houston. He won't even say a word. I can't even get him on the phone no more.
Why do they say that the young man can't come in church?
You tell me. I tell the presiding bishop to say that. He is the brother. He ain't done nothing, nobody.
He's who's the brother?
My brother has my father's disposition. He is very meek and mild. So it's needless to say we're different. So if they were gonna keep anybody out of the church, I'm surprised they didn't keep me out.
Just unilaterally did that a couple Sundays ago. So Sister Carol's the mother called me, shaking on the phone. So it's about to kill them. When I went there the first time, they told me I couldn't go. I said, you're going to have to hog tie me and take me to jail. I went in. This kind of foolishness is going on, and the general board ain't saying nothing. And they was, some of these ones that's doing this was the one was telling my Bishop Blake was breaking the law. Just a bunch of foolishness.
You think any of them are watching me tonight?
Oh, if not, they'll get the tapes, and they should get the tape, because this is just a warm-up for God bless them, what Osmond is going to go to, because we're not going to let this continue. This is wrong. They have stole over $1 million from this man.
Over how much money?
They owe Bishop Cowles over $1.7 million. That's the offer I gave him now. To avoid damages. Can you imagine what a criminal justice system will do to us? How do Bishop Thompson don't have no financial records? Don't you know you're supposed to be giving out 1099s and stuff? We know nothing. The Board of Bishops Grievous Committee has found him guilty of woefully keeping financial records. We don't have them yet. His sister was on the jurisdiction account. They took her off and didn't even tell her. And they won't give her accounting of the money before he shut the account. Is that right, Cassandra?
That's right.
And she's an attorney. She just wrote a letter to the presiding bishop asking for information that was supposed to be given because Kirk Thompson pled guilty to some of his crimes to the Board of Visual Review Committee. They are ignoring us, won't even respond. That's what we got going on right now. And she's an attorney.
Yo, this is crazy, man. This is the kind of stuff that you would think that folks that don't go to no church don't know who Jesus is.
This is what the drug dealers do right here.
What is going on right now? When I went to that church the first time, they wrote a letter saying, "See, I got a deal with her father for a dollar a month." And I went to the church first time, they wrote a letter saying I wasn't welcome. my culture church. Had all them off-duty cops there looking for me.
Kept us in the office with 7 police officers for 2 hours to keep us out of the church that Sunday.
And I told them, I'm going in and you're going to hog tie me and arrest me. And we called more cops and they told me I could go in the church. I said, I know I can go in the church. You can't lock nobody out of the church. And the general board is supporting this type of criminal activity right now. And if they don't call them man out at church and respect the board of bishops, give us committee findings and our constitution, we're gonna vote to impeach them all, and they should be prosecuted.
So
stealing money is a crime.
So where would the vote come from to impeach?
Oh, I don't know. I just have to make sure, though, that we do everything by the book, because at some point it will get before a judge and a jury, and I want to make sure we exhausted all of our inner avenues. See, they people talk about the courts don't get involved. They don't know what they're talking about. I testified in Orlando. They threw out Derek Hunter, and they went and vandalized the church. $77,000. The insurance company paid $55,000, and he is the new co-chairman of the leadership conference in January. Can you believe this stuff?
And you know, Moses, and people are wondering why God is moving across this country, why there is COVID, and people are dying.
They don't have no fear of that. Not these guys.
The word said that I will give you up to a reprobate man. Man, how can the folk who call themselves these saints, fire baptized, Holy Ghost filled, how can you carry this type of action on and deceive the very elect of God and think that God is pleased? And
no, he's not pleased.
And think that God's gonna let you get away with it. If God allows, let me finish this line. If God allows people to do what there are people in the church now, God is going to have to come back and apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. This is worse than anything that Sodom and Gomorrah could have did. Even when Brandon got that sissy Andrew Caldwell to go up and he been delivered, we all know that was staged. See, it's too much phonyism that's going on right now.
Oh, no, it is.
Well, Pastor Matthews, you answered your own question when you said reprobate mind.
Yeah.
That's how they are doing it. That's exactly
yeah, it's just
how once you've been turned over to a reprobate mind, you don't care about the word.
Yeah.
They don't care.
The word. They just simply do not care. And I don't know what it's going to take for them to care.
It's going to take the feds. See, her father didn't want to go down all these paths. Nor did I. He's 79 years old. He don't need to go through this no more.
Mm-hmm.
They don't care in a certain part because, like I said earlier, they're just going to waste the church money. Behind lawyers and playing games. But we're not going to wait for all that. We're going to bust this wide open because people need to know what's going on, starting with the General Assembly. So a lot of people just going to be hearing this for the first time. They don't know this stuff going on. The saints just shouting and dancing and praying.
That's it.
And giving up their little money.
And don't know what's going on.
And these guys riding motorcades. They're riding motorcades, taking money from the little poor people. They don't give them nothing. We got a thing going right now. I love my church. They ask for more money in a pandemic. People getting flooded out of their bed. What do we need more money for?
Well,
what are we doing with what we got?
How much money? You gave me this $4 million figure on the credentials. How much money do you think going through the Church of God in Christ?
Well, Bishop Blake's report that I sent you before. I estimated the numbers he called up as far as what's generated, though, we would be somewhere around $150 to $170 million.
Okay.
During his tenure, of just, if you go on what he said. So we just asked to see, like, the last 3 or 5 years or whatever, we ain't got no response yet. Now, we non-profit, mind you. You know, the law entitles us.
Right, right.
They won't show the
record. As comes through the Church of God in Christ, we should have a school, we should have a university, we should be giving away full scholarships. I'm not talking about $500 here or there. We should be sending students to school on full scholarships.
But at least get some gas cards.
And that credential card that you mentioned earlier, I'll put that in the comments. That credential card is not good for anything but getting you a front spot at the hospital.
A parking spot.
The card ain't worth the plastic it's printed on.
But see, we pay the money, Pastor, to support the church. And then you need to pay your registration.
Well, y'all got $100 million?
No. What? No, what? Because we have an I Love Your Church campaign.
We have that money on paper.
Well, I ain't even seen no paper. Bishop just gave the report with, in 2016. But I'm saying something else to you. We don't know what's really going on. I know we have our Love My Church campaign going on, but we need to raise more money, okay? But then after that, what they going to do? And then, I mean, I don't get it.
6 million members. How many members show up at the convocation? We claim 6 million members. How many people show up at the convocation on any given year? Nowhere near 6 million.
No one near a million.
No.
The membership is inflated. The money is inflated. It's just a big inflated lie. That's what it is.
Oh, God.
And
well, I know. I'm
the lies, and you got leadership at the helm of all those lies. And you got leaders sitting back, jumping and shouting, talking about I belong to the greatest church in the land.
And they just don't know that the management is not what it's supposed to be. And we're going to tell them.
If you work for a major corporation, all you care about is, am I going to get paid on the 1st and the 15th?
Mm-hmm.
That's all you care about. You don't know what's going on at the CEO's house. You don't know.
So
unless you know.
So the saints
go. They don't really care unless they get in trouble.
Yeah. So the saints are going to go to the churches to get an emotional feel good and then go home.
Shout and dance and raise about 3 or 4 offerings after you pay your registration and everything else, and that's basically it. They only hardly give a free bottle of water.
These people spend their hard earned money, their Social Security money, those who can fly to the convocation, save up that little $400 plane ticket for 6 months, and then the other people drive.
And go to the hotel?
Go in the hotel.
Have to eat?
Go
and basically,
eat.
Yeah, is it? That's,
you
what
know,
they're doing to the people.
You know, I, Moses, you know, I used to be in the repo business.
Yeah.
And I had a car lot in Chicago every year that would pay me $1,500 a car. They were hiding the Cadillacs and stuff in Chicago. But they would come to Memphis and flodge and drive them out of town, Cadillacs. Man, I would make $10,000-$15,000 sometimes during the convocation, because I didn't look for none of my other car lots. All I looked for was the saints.
I might be in the wrong business.
Shit. These were good Cadillacs, and couldn't nobody find them. Or the church members would hide them. Or on Sunday mornings, the church members would block pastor's car in. Whoa, but I would get you. I would get at least 8 to 10 cars every convocation. When they coming back to Memphis? Oh, I ain't in the repo business no more. Y'all doing it virtually this year, aren't you?
Well, yeah, I think so. Because they was trying to do it, I guess, like a cold thing, but I think they canceled because of COVID.
Okay.
But so, what we need to have is new elections, brother. I'm sorry, at least for the pastors and elders council. Chairman Thewson got some company called Buddy Buddy. We raised over $300,000, I think it was, in fees to have an election. and he wouldn't get, you know, like a Price Waterhouse, whatever. We needed something good, but we definitely need to have a chairman and, I mean, an elders and pastors council election. Mm-hmm. Less than 300 participate out of 12,000 pastors? No. Mm-hmm. We need new elections, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, when we gonna do part two of this show?
It will be soon. I'll let you know. And I'm going to talk to Ms. Parler. That's who you need to talk to. You really need to hear a story.
Yeah. Just how give her treated. Give her my personal number.
I will do that, sir.
Okay. Because sometimes this number, she called me on Wednesday's phone when I'm off there. So give her.
I love to hear her story.
I love to talk with her father if he would talk. I'm not going to push it. But if he wants to talk about the issue, let's talk about it. And I invite any official in the Church of God in Christ.
They're scared. That's not going to happen.
To call me.
Come on with them so they can tell me I'm wrong or whatever, and I'll correct the record.
Yeah. Call me.
I'll come on. I'll be happy to come on.
If you gentlemen don't know my number, email me. CussingPastor@gmail.com.
Yeah. Well, I had a brother tell me the other day, he said, you gonna go on the cussing pastor? I said, yeah, because the cussing pastor, frankly, is not a lying bishop. I am so, and not every bishop, so let's be clear on that. I'm talking about the ones I've dealt with in some of these cases. I am so sick of being lied to, and lied on. I'm sick of
it. I'm about to get me a bishop outfit. A cassock and one of them hats. And y'all like to wear them chains around your pocket. What's all that about? Putting your cross in your pocket and stuff. Y'all had.
They're making so many new auxiliary bishops now, and to my understanding, illegally. We have an injunction against it, and they won't be honest about that. So I mean, and some of these bishops, like early 40s or whatever, I mean, come on. And some of them been double married and everything. I'm not going on that deep. I'm saying we need to walk by the same rule. And that's why I'm going to end my thing tonight. I'm challenging the presiding bishop and the junior board and everybody else. Let's clean this up amongst ourselves because it's not going away. And my position is Bishop Cowles is a meek man. But some of this stuff is criminal behavior. And we need to start prosecuting it.
Well,
and all them goons up out of Bishop Cowles' church. Doesn't make any sense.
How do you move forward from taking it out of the jurisdiction of the Church of God in Christ into, and a lot of this stuff is federal.
I'm going to talk to you about that personally, Thaddeus, after we get off the plane, because I'm going to deputize you to do a few things, and I'll talk to you about that.
Well, you're going to say,
her father is not that kind of person, but I think he realized now they will have took everything he got.
Yeah.
My father is not that kind of person. But
that's what I just said.
I'll wear that same shirt that you're wearing right now.
Let me leave this with you, okay? I want you to pray for
you
me.
You need the order. Look. Yeah, what's your name, girl? So I won't miss her.
Isidra.
Who?
Isidra.
What, I call you your sister.
Okay, what they call you for baby, what they call you for short?
They call me Sissy or Sid.
Sissy. No, I ain't gonna call you Sissy. I'm gonna call you Sis, okay?
Just call
yeah, because I'm gonna mess up your name. Shirt. Baby, you need this shirt?
I need that. As Moses, do I need that shirt? I don't want to embarrass my family, but I need that shirt.
Send $25, baby.
I don't even know what the shirt is, and don't tell me. Please don't tell me.
It says,
I'll
tell you right now, it says, the fuck.
Oh, God, Lord have mercy. Jesus, Lord have mercy.
The fuck these bishops, these crooked ass bishops. The fuck these thieving ass bishops.
Oh,
the fuck these pedophile ass passing a 13-year-old boy around.
Oh, God.
The fuck.
Oh, God.
God damn it, the fuck.
Oh God.
Shit.
You know the only thing I know that I'll leave you with on that?
What?
I know it's some bishop gonna say, Moses don't let they cuss like that, but the problem they have is some of them cuss too. They just don't no, trust
no. Wait, wait a minute. Wait a minute.
No, don't say no more, sissy.
Moses.
No,
Moses.
Yes.
Fuck them.
Oh, God.
For Blake.
All right. I'll tell
you. No. For Blake.
Oh, look. He's not trying to get you off the phone, Pastor Matthews. He's trying to get me off the phone.
Girl, I done talked to you long enough to know you use these words, so shit.
Mm-mm. Oh, God.
You ain't meek and mild and humble.
I put ING on the end of some of mine.
Motherfucking, motherfucking bishops. Oh, fuck God. Them.
Hey, listen, Daddy, let me say this for the record. Oh, and I'm serious on this. I know you're serious, but I want to leave with this. And I'm saying this to everybody hearing me, your listeners especially. You got to get to know God for yourself.
I promise
you. Again, the individuals in Kojic are not bad. It's certain individuals we need to remove out of their positions.
Moses, you trying to change my flow. You trying to change my flow. See, I told my audience before you came on, I used to fuck congregation sisters every year at the congregation. The last time...
They were speaking in tongues.
Yes, sir. She had a goddamn hat on. She one of them big round lampshade hats. She pinned it to her head. I tore her ass up in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. She brought a brand new meaning to, oh, I'm coming, Lord.
Oh, God. That is?
What?
The only thing that saved me tonight is Joshua slipped his spine.
Who?
And they stayed at the harlot's house for more than one day. So, Lord said the same. We'll set up part two.
But see, I've been to a whole lot. See, no, wait a minute. I've been to a whole lot of church harlot's house. Okay? So they can pretend all this holiness. Okay? Some of these bishops, you sucking dick on Saturday night and then you come and laying hands on folks Sunday morning. We don't want your dick feel hands on us.
Oh God.
Hallelujah. Jesus coming in a Honda. I always wonder why you couldn't come in a Cadillac myself. But I'm gonna let y'all go, cause I shook up.
Bishop Porter show up because he's the one that called you with all this mess.
You know Brandon ain't gonna come.
I said he the one called you about Bishop Giles. Remember? He was waiting on me.
Woo.
Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, he called you with this.
Yeah.
So Bishop Porter, Pastor Matthews, thank you for having concern for the people. And leave this with your people. You got to know God for yourself.
Yes, sir.
Kojic is a great church, but we got to change management.
Yes, sir. And
are they going to come clean?
Right. And I expect your...
Thank you, Pastor Matthews.
Thank you, Doc. Look, he's going to give you my number to call me.
I will. And Miss Pollard.
Yeah. Give him my number to call me, and we can talk personally. Off air.
And a lady named Sister Jackson. I'm gonna let her talk to you too.
Yes, let Sister Jackson call me too. Moses?
Yeah, her mother signed paperwork. They sold the church underneath them. But that's another story. I'll talk to you later.
Huh? Well, you know, man, I'm Moses. Moses?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I thought I had got rid of you. Man, this has been a pleasure tonight.
God bless you, and y'all keep me in your prayers.
Talk about something that most other talk show hosts will not talk about. They ain't got the voices, they ain't got the balls to talk about it. Moses, I'll see you at the offering table.
All right,
God bless you.
All right,
y'all have a good night.
All right.
God bless
you here.
All right, man.
Good night. All right. Bye-bye. Lord have mercy, that was something else. Play Brother Moses. Play Brother Moses after them 2 hours. Can you believe what you heard tonight? And there's more to come. Thank you, Andrea. I think I shook Moses up a little bit, didn't I? That's the only, the one and only. That's, I play the organ like Moses. Moses Tyson. Instagram, I'm gonna save this one on Instagram. YouTube is automatically saved. Facebook is automatically saved there. The world needs to know that all these holy rolling ass folks, they playing. Minutes left in my time with you on tonight. This is going on in the church. And I can't get mad when folks say, I don't go to church. I serve God at the house. Thank you. I just played though. I'm sorry, Moses. Come on, Moses. In just a minute. If you want the fuck t-shirt, you know where to go. $25. Cash out. $ Naked Truth Ministries. Yeah, I can get the t-shirt for you in white. Yeah, you put your address in the comments, baby. Put it in the... Make sure you put your zip code in. All right. Let me see. That's Moses Tyson. This was a great show. This is one of my great shows. As I shared with you at the beginning of the program, for about the last week, I have not been feeling my best. I've been faking the funk. And the last 2 or 3 days, it's whatever it is has worn me down even more. I am very sure that it had something to do with my heart. You remember that at the beginning of the year, I told you that my doctor said that my heart was only beating at 38%. I went to, and they went to see, they said I had some blockages. And I went to have stents put in. But when they put me under, I didn't have the blockages. I have been doing pretty good. And as you can see, I am losing some weight. But today, as I was going to the post office, I could barely make 2 or 3 steps without stopping. I made it to my car, went to the post office. No, I went to the bank. Then I went to the post office. And I made it back. And I made it in the house. And had to fall on the couch. I made a call to a friend of mine, and we talked. And she said, "You need to call the doctor." People that know me know that I don't like doctors. So, I called my doctor, Dr. Lee Faulkner, and told him, when the secretary answered, I won't talk to the secretary unless you can give me an appointment for in the morning, because they give you them weeks out and months out. I need to see the doctor in the morning. So I'm going to get up and do my morning blues show. And I'm going to see the doctor at 10:45. You just want money. Baby, I got the insurance. Get the fuck off my page. You don't need money, baby, when you get insurance. The Blue Cross Blue Shield peoples. Because of my age, my insurance is high. Woo. So I'm dealing with some stressful things. And I got a lot on me. I got a lot on me. 99% of what I do it myself. So, I have a list with 30 things to do in a day and don't get but 2 or 3 of them done. But my mind leads me to go to the doctor. Like, I'm not worried about your money right this minute. so I'm going. Soon, I'm going to have to get up and get dressed. Soon as I get off the air. There's two accomplishments I'm trying to get. Bad chip. And then I am going to return to the office front. At least this part. Not the radio. That's too early in the morning for me to get up and put on some clothes and go across town. All right, so I may or may not do the show, according to what the doctor says, and according to what the doctor finds wrong, because something certainly is wrong. Yo, why you keep worrying about that motherfucking shirt? God damn! You hear me sitting here talking about, man, why you worrying about a goddamn shirt? How the fuck's the shirt gonna get there unless it get mailed? Quit being a silly motherfucker. You asking me about a goddamn shirt, and I'm talking about my heart. Bitch, bye. Damn. And again, it's according to what the doctor said. And if they don't keep me on tomorrow, or if they're going to give me a different medication. All right, join me in the morning. At 6 a.m. for the Best in Blues and Southern Soul. Those of you that like the blues and you're not in the blues areas on the radio, I don't want to talk nobody from no goddamn Oklahoma City. What the fuck you calling me for? If you ain't talking to me about no money, I don't want to talk to you. I don't know nobody in Oklahoma. If you like to get the fuck t-shirt, which I have to have made, I only have one medium here. This was a pallet shirt. My guy is already making shirts. The V-neck is 30. Selena wanted a V-neck. Okay. Probably will have all those shirts ready to go on Monday. But I ain't having them make no one shirt at a goddamn time. Sandy Williams, I didn't ask you for your advice. Okay? I ain't going to in the morning. The emergency rooms, you know, you folks are going to the emergency room. Can't get no emergency rooms in this city. I'm going to my doctor's office. If my doctor finds need, he can just make sure it happens. Okay. But please don't come on here and tell me where I need to go. Sandra Williams, ain't nobody asked you a motherfucking thing. Now, bitch, get off my motherfucking site. Sandra, you gone on my page. X-Men, they had mentioned that earlier to me in the year about open heart surgery. They also talked to me about one of them things going to your chest as well. Okay. We'll let the doctors do what the doctors do. Okay? All right. I'm going to save tonight's show. So, on that note,